Don't interrupt Dolly Parton.
She hasn't even started yet.
Wait.
Mouth it. Go.
He knows every word. He was singing it before this started, and now you're...
I was singing the whole thing.
I don't know. What's the thing?
Jump in the shower, blood starts pumping. Out on the street, cup starts jumping.
Oh, yeah. Now you're going to just cool Johnny Suave.
Week 37 of the Pitt and Cox Show, super special edition, as we have the grand forum of all things Pit Crew.
Ta-da! Well, I'm going to let my wonderful girlfriend introduce herself. Go!
Hi, I'm Cara Unicorn Jones, Team Cox. Woo!
I'm going to let my wonderful non-girlfriend introduce herself.
Tami Tuminello, Team Cox!
Cox, yeah!
Woo!
Team me!
Woo!
Hey, that guy wasn't there.
No one's Team Carlo.
They got bibs. I don't have bibs. No.
Team Piss is a miss.
Hey-o!
Okay, that makes me feel
kind of sad. Don't feel sad for me. I'm doing just fine.
It's everything today is going to be centered around Pit Crew.
Yeah.
Now, Cara and Tami, you Pit Crewed last year. In fact, all of us were there last year. Except for you.
Which is well known. Talking about beating the dead horse. Go ahead.
No, we're bringing it back. We revived the horse so we can kill it again.
Right. Clear! Good job. Bam!
You have experience crewing for not just World's Toughest Mudder, but what else have you done?
I have crewed for many 150-mile trail races for friends, and my favorite experience has been Badwater 3 years ago.
Who'd you crew for?
Arthur Webb.
No way, right?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. He broke his record and broke the record for his age group that year. He would tell me, if you see Dean behind me, let me know, and I can happily report that Dean Karnassus never passed Arthur Webb.
Dean Karnassus has never passed
Dean
Karnassus.
No?
No way.
Has he's eating a whole
bitch back here the whole time.
Has he ever been behind you, really?
He'd like to be, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, there it is.
But stop. For Aaron Davila, who not everyone in the group knows, because I don't think he's actually in the community, but he's still a fan of the show, and he's...
sent in some Puerto Rican rum for us to enjoy.
He traveled to Puerto Rico and got us rum from Puerto Rico. I feel like I'm going to be floating on sunshine once I have some of this wonderful rum.
I was just curious, do you think we should put like labels over this so it doesn't show?
No.
So now, all 9 foot tall of Aaron Davila said that we've got to give this a shot.
Can I give you my glass?
A moment. I just want to make sure I don't spill anymore.
God. Cheersies.
Cheersies, Aaron.
Aaron. Should we cover up the Starbucks logo?
Ready? 1, 2, 3.
Mm. Oh.
That's delicious.
That's smooth.
Not as bad as I thought it would be.
What was in my...
That's not glass, is it? What?
That's smooth though.
It's got a little heat afterwards, though.
Yeah, but, I mean, clearly Tami and I can handle our liquor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they're both talking about how smooth it is, and you're panicking. I wish we had smell-o-vision, because it's really runny. It feels like I'm about to have some tiramisu, but I know
it's not. Stop me. It's so good to not just have to be around you for this hour.
See, I don't feel that way
at all. I'm really enjoying it.
Don't worry, because, you know, I know tips and tricks.
Yeah, she
does. What Josh tells me if you
know
what I'm
talking about. Remember that one time it lasted 15 seconds?
I know. It was so good. It was good.
Hey, and I didn't cry that hard that time.
No.
It was I was in the zone. Yeah. Our baby.
Oh, yeah. Tell me about the baby.
It's the size of a leek.
How big is a leek?
Depends on how much I've drank in that day.
Yeah, I just took one little.
Hey-o! That was a pee joke. High fives, all across the board.
Urine joke.
Yeah.
How about a brisket?
Or like a
brisket.
Cancerous tumor.
Oh, what's that?
Well, those are various sizes, though.
What are you doing?
We were enjoying the beef, and then you just went.
A leek is
a giant green onion, right?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't want to do that again, but it's.
Yeah. Oh, I won't need to do that again. Go ahead. It's okay. We'll wait. I'll edit it
She's
out.
She's done it like 6 times already.
Yeah. Like this, and like this, like that.
This.
It's like this.
Week's about this big. Oh, it's bulbous at the bottom.
Is this what's happening?
Actually, Aaron, what week was it that Carlo taught me how to fondle balls?
Yeah, Aaron will figure it out.
Really?
Thanks, Aaron. Aaron Wally.
Yeah.
He's bringing someone as his pit crew.
Yep.
It's an old friend. The
oh,
most interesting man in the world.
Is he?
Yeah.
It's a cardboard cutout.
Yeah.
You'll meet him, all right.
Yeah.
You can hug him.
Really?
You can give him a kiss.
He's
but
a cardboard
don't
cutout?
Get too...
I won't get too first.
Yeah. You seen the Shock Top drought ads?
As a beer brewed in California, Shock Top knows there are easier ways to save water. Go to shockthedrought.com to learn smarter water-saving ideas. As a beer brewed in California, Shock Top knows there are easier ways to save water. Go to shockthedrought.com to learn smarter water-saving ideas. As a beer brewed in California, Shock Top knows there are easier ways to save water. Go to shockthedrought.com to learn smarter water-saving ideas.
They had some kind of a pumpkin.
Banana beer.
They had a pumpkin.
I love banana beer. Remember, I had banana beer in Vegas. Is pumpkin spice a thing people are into?
I think so.
Girls everywhere going crazy. Of course!
Yep. Pumpkin spice condoms.
Although not you.
No. I'm a basic bitch. Yeah. I'm just curious, what's this cardboard cutout got to do with anything?
He's bringing it, man. This is his pit crew.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Hey, try not to question things on the show. Just kind of go with it. That's how we roll.
Why are you bossing me around?
Why are you talking to my lady like that?
Yoko Ono's here, everybody.
You are.
Oh, excuse me. I'm like the best girlfriend ever.
I'm the best girlfriend ever, says every crazy girlfriend ever.
Do something.
Yeah, Carlo.
That's right.
Shut up.
Knock it off.
Brian Knoll.
Yep.
Why do I keep looking at the notes?
He's putting together the World's Toughest Mudder playlist. We requested two songs. Like, what would your two songs be?
Oh, right. Yeah. I gotta do that. Yeah.
So, what are your two songs?
Shit. You go first.
Okay. They would be Family Force 5, Chainsaw. Crane,
maybe I'm psycho, maybe you're right though. They said that about Warhol, they said it about Michael. Or maybe you're all wrong, maybe you're spiteful. I'm just a better me, it's like I'm recycled. If they never love themselves, how can they like you? I see how they judging you, don't let them indict you. They constantly killing you, don't even give life to. Jesus had haters and most were disciples.
Maybe I'm two songs,
babe. I don't think I know two songs.
You are such a big Dick Marks fan. over and over.
From, like Mercy Me or Toby Mac would be great.
I think the Best Around by
Joe Esposito.
Around. Oh, fuck. Yes!
What would your two songs be, Tami? Which Authority Zero song?
Who?
Yeah. Right, exactly. Yeah, that happens a lot.
Says everyone.
Cassie Harris has my back.
Stranglehold by Ted Nugent.
Wow, very nice, actually.
And that's long enough to qualify for five
yeah,
songs.
Yeah, right?
Here's something that I'm really stoked on. Todd Essen.
Yep.
He was not able to come back to do Worlds. He said this a long time ago.
Oh.
Unless his wife got pregnant.
Yeah.
Well, last night, he reminded everyone that was the only way he's going to be able to get to Worlds, and then he posted his Worlds registration ticket.
Yep.
Fantastic.
What I want to know is who got his wife pregnant?
That's a good question.
So, Todd, who's the lucky guy?
I'm going to guess Todd. It's going to be a good
right.
day.
Yeah.
Usually it's Carlo fixing my hair.
I know, right?
This is nice. You're a way better kisser. I'm just saying, you know. Way better.
Way better.
He keeps his eyes open the whole time. It's weird. Not very many people have that kind of hurdle to make it to World's Toughest Mudder.
So good for him.
What? Yeah. Like,
I love that hurdle.
I gotta raise some money to get the plane ticket. Like, I gotta get time off work.
Yeah.
I gotta make sure my wife is pregnant with my seed.
Yep.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
I think that's
yeah.
what's in order here. What? Bravo.
Yeah, round of applause.
Yep.
We had babies.
By yourself Woo! Or someone else.
Way to do it.
Godspeed.
Right. Godspeed.
Man.
It is.
Did Charles create this?
We are listening to DeBarge from Charles Hoffert's suggestion.
Speaking of Charles, I just want to thank him for the recipe with the jalapenos and the cream cheese and the chicken, and they came out looking nothing like yours or anything like the picture. And all night long, my whole face was on fire because I did not take the advice of wearing gloves while handling the jalapenos. So I accidentally went like this, I accidentally went like this, I accidentally went like this. So my whole head was on fire, including all of my fingers.
I tried rubbing milk and ice cubes all over her face. She wasn't having it.
It was terrible.
She actually got mad.
I did.
Brandon Peachy
yep.
put out there that
here's the
they
best
have,
names in this group.
I know. How you feeling?
Peachy.
You may not know this, but anybody who was there last year can attest to lugging your shit sucked.
Really?
I have.
Oh, yeah. He was putting out there that they have pretty cheap wagons.
Oh, I saw it. Yeah.
For like $60. That'll.
Great.
Yeah.
Isn't that what the pit crew is for? We just walk to the thing and they lug our stuff. Somebody get this shit? I'm seriously. Like.
What? So you're gonna show up in your wetsuit?
I thought my job was to race.
Attention, anybody pitting for Carlo, you're in for a terrible time.
Right.
He will be a diva.
So I hate to ever say that Carlo's kind of right, because I hate to say that.
Mm-hmm.
But as pit crew, mm-hmm. you know, you are in the ultimate service job. And when you're crewing for somebody, you know, you're showing them ultimate love. That's what you're doing. The return is that they're showing you the same by being respectful of your efforts.
Of course.
And doing everything there, you know, your...
everything we need.
Your mutter is there to...
Everything.
Down to sharing your pizza box.
Everything we need.
Yeah, right? Yes. Right.
Everything, yeah.
All three of us?
Yeah.
We're going to do so well this year.
We're going to do freaking awesome. I am really excited because I am going to bring a case of giant water bottles.
Hot water bottle trick.
That was like
that saved
the
our
most
life.
Genius thing.
Yeah. Warm water bottles.
Yeah.
I had like water bottles in my hands and my legs and all over.
Yeah.
And I learned that trick from my son. Thank you, Teddy, for that.
It did. It totally saved our lives.
What else are we going to do?
Step in your pants?
Shut up. It's going to be a great time the three of us are going to have.
So
it would be so great to run with you. You're really the only person like that I can think of that would be great to run with. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know.
What?
You remember last year?
So good.
When we were in that tent in the middle of the night and there was that girl there that was like shoving food in people's mouths and...
Tracy.
Yeah. Tracy Watson. Has
God.
You're a legendary, you, Tracy.
I am your biggest
the
fan.
The pit bull of the orphan tent.
Walking along and this guy was just walking along and he looked really like... I mean, he looked awful. And he had his mouth just slightly open and you had something in your hand and you literally shoved it in his mouth. And he just started chewing. You walked away, he walked away. You
there you go. Mutual, you smell it. Exactly.
Now.
You chew. Nom, 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 nom. Go.
I tell you what, if there is a zombie apocalypse during on November 14th, that's exactly where I want to be because everyone in this community is fucking nuts.
Right.
Like, and survivalists, and like, that's, you are in the safest place you could possibly imagine.
There's not going to be one.
But if there is.
But there's not going to be.
There's going to be a clown zombie apocalypse led by Robert Croder.
It's gonna be wicked scary, kid!
Ken Jacobus.
Happy birthday, Ken.
Happy birthday!
By the time this airs, it's not your birthday anymore, but happy birthday today.
Happy birthday a while ago.
Yeah.
But we filmed for your birthday.
That's
why
it's the only reason we filmed on Friday.
If you want a tent that isn't gonna make you want to hang out.
The Ken Jacobus micro tent?
Posted. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So you can, like, fit maybe half your body in there so you get to decide which half.
You know those ones at Walmart that, like, show you what the tents look like? It's like that.
Yeah.
How can we be expected to teach children to learn how to read if they can't even fit inside the building?
That's why I want the smallest
house. It's like 14 inches by about 12 inches.
So that's why I want a tiny house, so nobody can move in.
I think Justin got like a six-room condo. Yeah.
That's okay.
You know what? And I'm fine with that because last year,
you know what?
I think I was begging and cussing and ready to beat everyone to get in the tent.
Do you remember me?
It's well known that pizza is what I latched onto last year.
Yeah.
Oh. Heather Kerr posted the tin in a triangular shape that you wear around your neck and you can score pizza and make
it's a pizza pouch. The pizza pouch.
Wonderful.
I know.
Pizza pouch.
Yeah. You need to get some of that.
Yeah.
Because
right?
that's
your
savior. We got so much stuff. Like, here's all the goos and the beans and the gels and the
tailwind.
Here's all the fruits and the various drinks. And I ended up just wanting pizza. After all that stuff, just wanted pizza.
Yeah. So I ate all the junk food, the M&M's and the cookies and all that.
I had wine.
I just remember you did like the pizza.
You weren't there!
I had wine. I had lots of wine.
I had wine and regret. Battle Frogs race designer is going to be on course doing worlds this year.
Oh, the bearded guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I think you mean the beard.
Yes.
Christopher Ford. You can't have that beard without being a super cool dude. That's the way I see it.
You could.
No.
You're
wrong.
You can be a big beard and be a dick.
No.
You can't. Not him.
Yeah.
I'm just saying it's possible.
You could.
Yeah.
Totally. I totally agree with.
Yes.
Yeah.
Piss over here.
Yeah.
He's wrong.
That's why we don't have people between
the
two.
No. He's right on this one.
No, he's not.
Totally.
Right. You don't take a shot.
Listen, you know,
listen to my non-girlfriend over here.
Wait a minute. I'm about to agree with you guys. Think of somebody we know with a massive beard.
My dad? He's awesome.
That's not
Oh my god!
He's fantastic.
No, like, are you saying my dad is not a great individual?
Here we go.
Edit that out. Do you need any questions or something?
That's what we're on to.
Let's do it.
Time for community questions. What? You did not tell me that we had a Q&A session. session.
Oh, it's happening.
It's happening. Okay. So Sinica Pittman, you guys know Sinica.
Of course.
If I only have one pit crew member, should the pit crew stay out the entire time, or should pit crew go back to the hotel and take a nap?
This would be my advice to her is the nap. I mean, it's a nice pit pipe dream, but I don't see it happening. It's a pit pipe dream. Yeah. Because once you're out there, it's really hard to kind of dial it back, even as a pit crew person, because you're like on guard.
So what you're saying is like there's not going to be very many moments where you're like, you know what? Now's a good time to take a nap.
The second question was, if the pit crew does go take a nap, what would be the prime time pit crew should be out pitting?
That depends on the mudder. I'm really glad she's asking this question because one of the main things I do when I'm going to crew for somebody is I have a pre-crew meeting and say, like, okay, let's talk about what we think is going to happen, so we have a plan A. Then let's go through some variables. That way you can kind of have a plan of action of what's going to happen, but so you can kind of decide on these kind of things in advance when you think you're going to need the most help and when you think maybe you can do without.
That's a great answer.
Thank you.
Josh is great.
Yeah.
Aww! So Hanna Copper, who we all know, who will not be running this year, sadly, we all know.
Aww.
But she says, who will Team Copper, which is Hanna and her mom and dad, pit crew for?
Orphan tent!
Go to the orphan tent.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tracy Watson's gonna need some soldiers. Yeah.
Although if you see any one of us on the course, like, face down, please pick us up and point us in the right direction.
Dust you off.
And get out that way. Go direction. Good.
Here's some cake.
Follow the flashing red lights. Dillon De Hart says, how should a pit crew member plan their time? Last year, I had three members who were able to split up and find me on course / wait at the tent, and I would always run into them this way. He only has one this year, and he's wondering the best method to offer both support on the course and in the pits.
That's a very, very
one pit crew. That'd be tough with one pit crew.
Here's the thing with having just one pit crew person is that way your fellow mudders and their pit crews are going to know that you're going to need some extra support. So that's when you call in the reinforcements like myself or Tami to help with those kind of things.
Neighboring pit crews, I think we'd be more than happy to help out.
And I can tell you that from a participant's standpoint, if I had to choose, like, okay, I got one pit crew member, where should they be?
Right.
I would say be at home base. Like,
that way you always know where to find
them. Yeah, there's plenty of people on course, plenty of volunteers where if, like, you run into a sticky situation, you're going to need that person who's at home base who can
change your shoes.
Right, help refresh you.
Dillon has a follow-up.
Sure.
He says, how should the W2M participant repay their pit crew for helping?
Well, what do you think?
A car, a house,
a trip
to the Caribbean.
There you go.
Yeah.
Maybe Hawaii. That would work.
You know, if that happens, I'm pitting next year.
Yeah, that's exactly doing the wrong thing.
I am pit crewing for
What do you think?
Repay me by having the most wonderful time ever.
Oh, reaching, fine.
No,
you have to, like,
reach
go
your goal,
there.
Reach your goal. That's how you repay me, is by reaching the goal you set.
Catch miles.
Enjoying your experience.
Can't do it without you.
You're the best.
You are.
No, you're the best. All right, guys. I just can't get over you. Like, here's you, here's me. I'm trying to get over you. I just can't get over you.
Patrick Guzik says, what's the appropriate punishment for failure to have a PB&J ready when you arrive?
Oh, you should just cut the bitch.
Spanking!
Cut the bitch. No, no messing around. You want a PB&J, you should have a PB&J.
So I'm saying.
You cut the bitch if she's
not. I can't believe I talked about this.
Erik Krebs, this year my wife of 17 plus years will be my pit crew, and while it might be easy to spot on the course during the daytime, and in turn, she might be easy to spot, look for the Captain America gear and the Kindle, he's wondering if seasoned pit crew members might suggest a verbal method of identification that we can use. For example,
we got it.
Do you happen to know of a simple five-letter or less unique to us word that we can yell out to spot each other out there? I was thinking the first names, but I know there are other Aarons in the group.
Aaron, Mr. Krebs.
Yeah.
I'm guessing he is saying that maybe we should yell out Krebs?
Krebs.
Is what he's thinking?
If you yell Aaron or Aaron, you can get a lot of heads turning.
Yeah.
And at nighttime, and you're delirious and you're tired, it might sound like crabs.
So everyone I know, I'm going to start yelling, Krebs!
Yeah.
And when I see Maddie, I'm going to go, Krebs!
We're thinking the answer is Krebs.
It is the answer.
But
we have a fun way of identifying our tribe.
Legitimately, this is what was used last year.
Go ahead.
And I have to give props to my son who started
your baby
this.
Boy.
Yes.
So both of our baby boys have contributed in amazing.
Yeah. That's amazing.
So Josh is coming into town.
Yeah.
He screams,
Kaka! Kaka!
I'm Pit Person Ice Cream. I'm a pony! I'm a pony!
So you yell caca caca?
Yeah. And it's legitimately what Aaron was asking about, okay. Only we really did it last year. Okay. And it worked a couple times legitimately.
Let's know you're on the way.
Yeah, because you know, out of the sea of people, you can call it out, and your people will hear that and respond back in kind, and it worked actually really well.
Got it. Like, who's gonna...
And we would get lost sometimes. Like, I'd be like, caca caca! And then she'd be...
I'm a pony! I'm a pony!
I'm like, oh, there you are!
Yeah. I'm a Clydesdale.
Our buddy Khanh.
Khanh!
Yes.
Did it.
Once and nailed it. Should pit crew members get some training in deep tissue massage?
All right. Okay.
No. I think so.
No. Apparently. What's our answer, babe?
What's our answer?
If it's readily available, it can't hurt.
If it's readily available, it can't hurt.
Patrick Guzik says, how often should a prostate be checked by the pit crew?
You checked mine
an inordinate amount of times.
Yeah,
it was
like,
an inordinate
I'm like, the race isn't for another 3 hours. Like, what are you doing? How is it?
Erik Panu wants to know, what should pit crew members wear?
Let's talk about this. Everything they own, if it's cold. Because
everything.
It was freezing last
night. Because I literally put on every single piece of clothing that I own.
You need to wear everything, because it was freezing as shit.
We had, marmot gear. We're not talking, this wasn't a sweatshirt from Old Navy. I mean, we're talking legitimate...
No offense, Old Navy.
No offense, Old Navy.
All the offense, whatever. Old Navy. Yes. Yes. You have
but
shitty clothing.
My point. Clothes that are designed for cold weather, and I'm still freezing to death. So don't underestimate desert.
I had two pairs of pants on. I had every jacket, every shirt.
Lots of pockets.
Yeah.
Mathieu Lo, I think, is going to ask the best question of all the community questions, because it's the most real, in my opinion. He says, at what point does a pit crew member stop shouting words of encouragement and forcing people back onto the course to instead say something like, maybe you should quit before you injure yourself for life? If the runner is complaining about pain, how do they know? How would us runners be able to explain to them if it's muscle soreness / discomfort / shin splints or plain old, my body is broken and may never heal because I'm pushing myself past its limits?
Thank you.
That's a really good question.
Matthew's my favorite Asian, by the way.
Ming's my favorite Asian, but Mathieu, we can
start shit.
So let's talk about that, because that's a very good, important question.
Yes.
I think we spent a lot of time, actually, with Jackie last year. Mm-hmm. And when she came in, I don't know, it was in the middle of the night, 3 o'clock in the morning or whatever. And I think she struggled quite a bit of whether she should go back out or whether she should stay in. And we really just spent a lot of time talking to her and, you know, basically how she felt and where she was. It's maybe in the moment.
Yeah, and I also think, and you guys can tell me from a pit crew perspective if you agree or not, I think it depends on how well you know your person.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, this is where it goes back to, if I can interject, is when it goes back to your pre-race planning, is to kind of have that conversation. I've had this conversation with many people I've crewed for, and I've said, you know, there's going to be times where you're going to be in a bad way, and I have a really thick skin. And as a pit crew person, you need to have a thick skin so your mutter can say, shut the fuck up, and you don't take it personally.
Right.
It has nothing to do with you.
I remember having a moment like that. I forget what lap it was, but coming in, and just I just can't talk right now.
Yeah.
Like, do you remember that?
We're super lucky on our pit crew because we have the luxury of two medical assistants, being Tami and Maggie. And so what I did at the beginning, I took the liberty of making sure I tracked every single one of their laps. Every time I'd ask them, have you urinated? Have you had bowel movement? Have you eaten? I'd keep track of what they ate. That way, if I saw a major difference in anything that they were doing, I could say, hey, he hasn't eaten in a while, or he hasn't gone to the bathroom. Can you kind of take a look at them and see what
you see the signs before, things
are... Here's the thing, you guys are awesome, all of you mutters who do this, and you're out there, you know, doing these intense events, and I think sometimes you forget that normal people don't do these things, and that being out there 24 hours is a major toll on your body. And I know you guys know all that, but you're so superhuman the majority of the time, you know, people like me are like, oh my God, you know, I want to make sure that he's not overdoing it, because every day is different. This is a big experience, and I get the goals that you set, but at the same time, you have to go back to real life and not injure yourself permanently.
Okay.
But some people are
they
mistake stubbornness for willpower.
Right.
And there's a big difference between the two, and that's where you have to discipline yourself.
Right.
Also, being, you know, really hyped up because, you know, you just want to get that goal, but you're frozen. Mm-hmm. You can't really negotiate whether this is an actual true injury
Or, I was just reading recently, and I've heard about this before, taking too many pain relievers, like acetaminophen and stuff like that. That's
exactly what happened to the American Gladiators.
Thank you.
I'm just saying, mm-hmm. It boils down to knowing your person.
Right.
And being able to assess the situation in a real way. Like, being able to say, hey, I think there's a big problem. And that's what medical people are there for as well. Like, if you think it's that at that point, get it medically assessed. Yeah. Like, don't be scared to do
tent,
that.
Go to the tent, have it check out, you know.
Keep checking your time.
15 minutes, whatever, but that's not going to hurt you.
Well, and for any new people out there, too, at the end of, like, during the night ops, you have to check in with a medical person after every lap. And it's not like a full-on check-in. They'll assess you. And I remember going through and you know, I'm very clear-headed. I'm good. Okay, yeah, you're good to go. And seeing other people stumble in and they're like, come over here. Mm-hmm. Take a seat. Let's take a look at you. Right. You know what I mean? So they also assess you.
When in doubt, check it out.
Oh, God.
So Ryan Scully says, how early are we able to set up our tent in the pit? And how will you know where to set up?
Good question.
It all depends on your Legionnaire status.
Okay.
If it's like last year. The more Tough Mudders you've run, the earlier you can set up. And I suggest the earlier the better.
Okay.
The earlier the better.
Mm-hmm. Chris Maxfield wants to know, what is the new appropriate time to make the in and out run? Also, he says, is it job abandonment if your pit crew says, screw all this wind, I'm gone? I gathered from the comments shortly thereafter is that Chris Maxfield may have abandoned his post last year on Shark Bay.
You might as well have walked out of a nursing home on fire.
Boom! Well,
you walk out on your pit crew, you walk out, that's the worst. You don't walk out on your pit crew.
Never, ever, ever.
Well, the irony here is that Chris Maxfield, if that is what happened, he's running this year.
He's running, yes.
So,
never, ever.
We'll find out, Chris.
I love you.
Grab him by the wetsuit zipper.
I believe in you.
Yeah.
Yep.
And you push their ass right back out onto the course.
That's right.
And if a thumb gets in the brown star as you're pushing,
that's okay too.
It's okay.
That's
it's a little
boss.
Added motivation.
Brown star?
That was for Savannah Hill.
Butt stuff.
Charles Haupert says, how do I keep my pit crew from inevitably falling asleep? Should you expect at some point a crabby, angry mutter yelling at you?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
I expect many crabby, angry mutters yelling at me.
Yeah, we had a lot of them.
Well, the flip side to that as a participant, and I know not everybody operates this way.
We didn't fall asleep.
No, you didn't fall asleep at all, but if I were to have come in at, you know, 1 a.m. and you're like kind of crashed out, I would understand. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I would come in and be like, fuck yeah, you've been waiting here for a couple hours. I would also be like, hey, I need some help.
Yeah.
And then, like,
Once again, it goes back to your pre-plan. It's your pre-plan. Like, I might fall asleep. Feel free to come in and shake my teeth out.
You guys are also having an experience in and of itself where you're doing an extreme amount of work. It's just different. And so it's like, I think it comes with understanding on both parties. And what you do is you just wake your pit crew's ass up. And if they don't respond in kind, well, then you got a different issue.
Right.
They're like, what are you doing waking me up? Be like, I'm changing pit crews is what I'm doing.
I'm fucking here. You gotta help me.
And
are we not supposed to cuss on this show?
No. Are you kidding me?
Where's my fucking banana? And salt.
And then you know what to do?
Shit.
In your mouth.
We'll put your banana up your ass, Carlo. That's where your banana is. I'm so proud that you just said that right now because I wanted to say it, but then I was like, I should probably be appropriate. Michelle Haupert.
I want to meet her.
Mrs. Gingerbread.
Mrs. Man.
She has a pit crew noob question. How often should I encourage my world's toughest mutter to eat and drink? How do I know how much food or drink to give their world's toughest mutter?
That's a very good question. Tami is the medical person. What? Which I know better than I would. But
no.
Evidently not.
It's basically.
Thanks, Tami.
I mean, you were the one that. Stop it. Listen. She was the one
I'm
that
so confident now going into
everything.
This. Tami, I don't feel good. What do I do? Shit, I don't know, bro.
I don't know.
Get back out there.
Go.
Rub some dirt on it.
Go
take an aspirin. I don't know.
Get this up your ass. Get out of here.
Exactly. Peel and peel. Peel and peel.
You have to know your mutter, and luckily it's your husband, so you kind of know what his appetite's going to be like. Like, when Josh came in and he didn't want, like, the peanut M&Ms or the cookies, I wasn't surprised by that. And when he wanted pizza, I actually, it was like basically every lap that he came in, I'd offer him something.
Right.
And I would think about how long he was out there, how many calories he probably burned. And if his stomach was queasy, I never want to force anything, but you want to send him off with a goo or some sort of nutrition source so they have something on the course.
Basically just reminded everyone where they were because you had charted who had what and when. that you haven't had anything to eat for two laps.
Right.
You need to refuel.
Get it.
What can we get you?
Having it marked how often I was peeing made me drink even when I didn't really want to drink anything because I knew I needed to.
Right.
It was like,
right.
Yeah. And my whole goal was I just need to make sure that I keep peeing. And so it's like, you know, as long as you keep making sure that your mutter is fed and drinking and you're keeping track. Is that it?
That's it.
I think we totally
like, talked the whole fucking time. Oh.
We totally held this show together today.
Yeah.
We did.
Yeah.
Well, thank you guys for having us, right?
Thank you for being on.
Yeah, yeah, right?
We're happy to be here and love to participate in the show. Thank you.
Calm down a little bit. I gotta go. She has to go. She just walked out.
There it goes.
Go.
You just left me here with them?
I love you.
Okay. Love you too. Okay, bye. Have a fabulous day.
There it is.
Love you.
Thanks, buddy.
Thank
you.
Bye.
Tonka.
Jesus.
No, Tonka, actually. 37, Piss and Cock Show. We'll see you guys next week.
Wait, hold on.
We're going to say cheersies.
Cheers.
Cheersies.